From the Sunshine State, this is Tampa Bay's Tan Talk.
I've paid my dues time after time. I've done my sentence, but committed no crime. And bad mistakes, I've made a few.
Welcome to the Half Empty, Half Full radio show on the Tan Talk Radio Network with your host, Laurie Zoock, the consumer champion. So listen up every Thursday night from 11 p.m. to midnight and learn something new. All opinions are that of the hosts and guests. Have a story idea? Contact us through Facebook on Half Empty, Half Full. We want to hear from you. And now, here's your host, the consumer champion, Laurie Zoock.
Welcome to the Half Empty, Half Full Talk Radio Show on the 1340 AM Tan Talk Network. I'm your host, Laurie Zoock, and each week we'll be discussing problems and solutions, changing negatives to positives, and helping you, the consumer, from being scammed by becoming better educated. Today we'll be talking about legal issues surrounding foreclosures, loan modifications, and more. My guest today is attorney Mike Waslick. Mike, why don't you just share a little bit of your background before we kind of jump into the topic?
Absolutely. I have been practicing law in, I've been admitted to Florida Bar since 1995. So it's, the years have gone by pretty quickly. But so I've been practicing law for some time now. And what I've been focusing on in my practice for the last several years, almost a decade now, is representing consumers in foreclosure, representing consumers against banks in foreclosure cases, as well as other issues that arise out of their financial situations, for example, debt, collection practices that are abusive or otherwise illegal.
Gotcha. All right. Well, we're going to jump in this quarter and we're going to talk about loan modifications and suing servicers. So the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau recently announced that they have new regulations. Can you first define for me what is the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau and what purpose does it serve?
Absolutely. Back in 2011, as a result of some of the things that were happening in the financial industry, the collapse that Wall Street basically caused for us, the Congress passed what's called the Dodd-Frank Act, which reformed the financial industry from top to bottom. And as part of the Dodd-Frank Act, the Consumer Finance Protection Bureau was created. And the job of the Consumer Finance Protection Bureau is to act as a watchdog over finance-related industries as they interact with consumers. So we talk about credit cards, the mortgage industry, everything that's related to that. Those fall within the jurisdiction of the CFPB.
Okay. And now I see also on that on their website, you can actually file a complaint against these companies such as banks, correct?
Yes, you can. You can complain directly to the CFPB. And also, too, there's provisions in the law and under the new regulations that allow you to go for civil enforcement, which means you can go into court yourself with the assistance of a lawyer without one, if you're so inclined, and to try and vindicate your own rights there if you feel you've been abused.
Okay. How do the regulations affect the loan modification process? And also, I'm going to back up. Explain what a loan modification is. A lot of people think they know what it means, but they don't really.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, first of all, if you have a home loan, many times, especially in the heyday, the 2005, 2006, 2007, a lot of people got loans which were not necessarily to their advantage. And so it is possible to ask your bank for a loan modification, which simply is changing the terms. If you got an adjustable rate that is adjusting beyond what you can pay, you might want to call them up and say, we want to modify our loan and get a fixed rate, or you know, try and get a lower interest rate, or which is not necessarily the same as a refinance, by the way. A refinance is when you got another loan to replace the loan you've got. A modification is where you go to your existing lender and say, we want to change the terms. And while the bank is not required to modify your loan in most cases, they are required to listen to you if you ask them under the new regulations.
Okay. Now, talk about the expanded rights to sue the loan servicers for failure to properly handle a loan modification. Because that's a biggie.
That's a huge one. One of the things that drives people crazy, when people come to me for help, the thing that they complain about most often is the way they've been treated in the loan modification process. If they're anticipating financial distress, if they think they're going to be able to, if they think they're not going to be able to make their payments, they will often call in and say, I want help. And one of a couple different things will happen. One is that at least a few years ago, it was very common for banks to tell their borrowers, we can't help you until you are behind on your payments. So go ahead and miss some payments and then we can help you. And people followed that advice. It was terrible advice because what would happen then is they would miss payments and suddenly they'd find themselves getting sued for foreclosure and there would be no loan modification. Another example of abuse that was happening time and time again is people would fill out applications provided by the banks together with just enormous amounts of detailed information, bank statements, pay stubs, tax returns for months, if not years. And they would submit this to the bank. And the bank would say, well, we never got it. The documents are stale. We need you to submit them again. There's something missing. And people would do this 5, 6, 7, 10 times and get no results. And they wouldn't even get a real answer. They wouldn't even – not even a we're denying you because you don't qualify. They'd say – the banks would say, we're denying you because we don't have all your paperwork, when the borrowers, the consumers – knew they had submitted everything and they could prove it. They've got the fact sheets, they've got the email reports, they knew they'd given everything and the banks just conveniently lost it. And some of the reason behind that, at least at the time, was that in some circumstances, the servicers had an incentive based on their fee structures. They got paid to process loan mods, not to give them. And so it was in their interest to make people go through the process time and time and time again.
Now, I'm going to jump in because I've heard the same thing. I've heard that they've gotten paid up to, say, $2,000 to just to review it, but not necessarily approve it. Have you heard that?
Well, I haven't heard any specific dollar numbers, but I do know that there were absolutely fee structures in place that encouraged the banks and their servicers to process the applications without actually granting them.
Okay. Now, you know, we like to share stories on the show. I like to go through the nightmare stories because then in the end, we kind of come back with solutions. And I've heard a lot of stories about homeowners. You know, they're told verbally that they have a loan modification. So in other words, they'll talk to someone at the bank. Maybe they're doing it over the phone. Maybe they are submitting paperwork. But it's not actually a written contract. They're just verbally told, hey, yep, if you pay X amount of dollars per month, which, you know, is probably while they're reviewing it, they're still getting some money in. What do you say to that? How does that happen?
Well, deals like that are worth the paper they're not written on. So if it's not in writing, it doesn't exist. If it's not signed off on by the bank, it doesn't exist. And if it's told to you on the phone, I just tell people, if they're telling it to you on the phone, it's as good as a lie. And often it's, let's just say it's not accurate.
Right, because anything, if it's not, you know, it's funny, in my own business, I tell people the same thing. If you do not have it on paper, signed by an authorized person, on letterhead, it doesn't count because anything verbal really, you know, people say verbal, yeah, yeah, it counts, you can go. How hard is that to prove in court?
Well, it's not just hard to prove. When you're dealing with a loan modification, the original loan paperwork will usually say you can't modify it unless we do it in writing. So there's a contractual provision in the mortgage contract, the loan contract that was originally signed, that says we can't modify it verbally.
Okay. Now, sometimes, you know, they'll be told that they have a loan modification and then they're sued for foreclosure. What happened?
Well, very oftentimes you will hear stories like that. I hear it all the time where somebody is called in their bank. They're told that they're either in the modification process or they've got a loan mod, so don't worry, that foreclosure is going to stop or we're not going to file for foreclosure. But the problem is the people who are on the other end of the phone don't know what's going on in the rest of the bank. These banks are huge institutions, and they don't talk to each other inside, and they don't talk to their lawyers. So what may have happened in many cases is that the bank has already sent the file to a foreclosure law firm to start foreclosure proceedings, and that can take months, or, you know, I've seen it take years for the foreclosure law firm to process it and get to the courthouse. So, but the person on the other end of the phone may not know that, or may not have access to that information. And so the left hand just doesn't know what the right hand is doing in most of these cases.
All right. That's scary to me because you have a big corporation that seems like it's out about making money and lots more money. But then you have the lawyers who aren't being notified of what's going on with the, you know, the process if they're going through the modification. And they're not talking to each other, and then people are starting to panic. So we've got a few more minutes before we go to break. Can you share with me, give me one of your, maybe your worst stories that you've heard?
They really all fall into the same couple of categories. Is either someone's told that the bank is not going to foreclose on them because they have a deal, or it's the loan mod treadmill that we've talked about time and time again. And the good news is that type of thing now, at least in theory, shouldn't happen, because now we have new regulations from the CFPB that say that govern the process about how the banks are supposed to process these loan modifications. There's supposed to be, for example, a single point of contact for each bank. So when the borrower calls in, they're talking in theory to the same person every time. The bank is supposed to keep records of what they've got. If they don't get the loan mod application processed in time, or they don't have all the documents, they have to notify the borrowers in time. And all of these regulations come with teeth. Now, they may not be big teeth or sharp teeth, but they exist. And so if a bank has done something against the rules, there are recourses under the law.
Well, you said in theory. I like those two words, in theory, because does that mean you're saying that the homeowner themselves has recourse, or is whatever the penalty is going to, you know, some government agency as a fine? Is it actually helping the homeowner?
That's a really good question. A lot of the settlements we've seen so far have been money paid to the federal government. In fact, the state of Florida took a big chunk of the foreclosure settlement, and instead of distributing it to homeowners who were abused by the process, they sent it to the court system so the court system could process foreclosures faster, to throw people out of their homes faster. So the good point you raised is that these regulations, the recourse that is present in this law, will allow the individual borrower to file suit against the bank and recover money for themselves in the form of statutory damages, actual punitive damages, and the like.
All right. Well, we're going to take a short break. When we come back, we're going to be talking more about mortgage foreclosures and loan modifications and that kind of thing with attorney Mike Waslick. Stay with us. We'll be right back.
Consumers, do you have bad credit? Can't purchase a house or car? Paying too much in interest on your credit cards and loans? Scammed by credit repair companies? There is hope. You can get back on track and do it the right way. Call Credit Education Consultants today at 813-500-6064. That's 813-500-6064. Or go to crediteducationconsultants.com now and get the help you need. Don't delay. Call today. Mortgage reps and realtor inquiries are also welcomed. Do you suffer from back, neck, or body pain? Do you suffer from migraines or have jaw or face pain? Has conventional medicine failed you? Were you injured or in an accident? Call chiropractic physician Dr. Dan Maddock at 813-935-1664. Dr. Dan has helped thousands of patients gain relief for more than 30 years. Dr. Dan is caring, gentle, and takes his time with each patient. He's also a past president of the International Craniopathic Society, a special certification of only 300 chiropractors worldwide. Dr. Dan helps patients from the neck up and the neck down. Dr. Dan accepts most insurance plans. Don't continue to live in pain. Call 813-935-1664 today. That's 813-935-1664. And get on track to better health. You're listening to the Half Empty, Half Full radio show on the Tan Talk Radio Network. And now, here's your host, the consumer champion, Laurie Zoock.
We're back, and my guest today is Mike Waslick. He's an attorney at law in the Tampa area. And we're talking about loan modifications, suing servicers. I can't say that word today. Different issues, Consumer Financial Protection Bureau, what your rights are and so forth. And Mike, I want to continue on by asking you, why is there a rush to push all the foreclosure cases to trial in this area? I mean, are we still in that rocket docket rush, get them in, get them out, it doesn't matter what the law says?
The rocket docket is kind of gone in waves. And right now we're seeing in this last few months, we're seeing another rush to get as many foreclosure cases processed as possible. And that command actually is coming from the very top. I was in trial in December, and we were talking to the judge during a break, and she was telling us that the Florida Supreme Court has come down with a guideline, shall I say. And the guideline is that of all the foreclosure cases pending in the state, the court systems, each circuit, each area court is supposed to reduce its caseload by 30% by a particular deadline. I think it's coming up in June of this year. And if they don't do so, then their funding won't be renewed for the extra foreclosure processes that are going on. So the courts are feeling a lot of pressure to reduce their caseload. Now, the total caseload right now is about 300,000 cases statewide. And so the goal that has been imposed is to reduce that number to 200,000. Now, that doesn't count the fact that there are thousands of new cases being filed every month across the state. So not only do they have to knock out a third of what is already existing, they also have to keep pace with the new ones that are coming up. So the courts are under tremendous pressure to get these cases through the system and out of the system. And what that means is that they are spending very little time on each one, and they're unable to, where cases really have complex issues, which not all do, but some do, where cases have complex issues, really their ability to spend time to fairly decide those issues is compromised because they have this pressure from above.
Okay, and I know you can see the look on my face, but the listeners can't, because I'm going, wow, 300,000 cases and more coming through. That to me is that's a frightening number, because it sounds one of my topics I like to talk about on the show is bad customer service. That sounds like a perfect example of bad customer service. It's like a large company, even if it's the court system, trying to kick things through regardless of what the outcome is, except that courts are held to a higher standard, correct?
Absolutely. Courts are held to a constitutional standard. They're required by the highest law of the land to give everyone a fair shake when we step into the courtroom.
Well, then why is nobody enforcing that? Because they enforce themselves.
That's part of it. Again, the mandate to process as many cases as possible comes from the very top. And so what we've seen, unfortunately, is that while ultimately the fairness of any particular process is going to come down to the people who implement it. And I have handled foreclosure cases across the state for years, and I have seen individual judges take very particular care to ensure a fair process and to ensure a fair result. And I have also seen judges who have responded to the pressure from above and give less attention to whether the process is fair and whether the result is fair.
Right. And that's not a fair that's not fair in those specific cases, but those few bad apples are hurting, the good ones. Now, do you think that, and this is a general statement, do you think that judges just want to get the cases through quickly because most of the homeowners won't have the money to appeal even if they have a legal reason to do so?
Well, I absolutely see the lack of appellate resources as a factor. And in fact, not only have I experienced this, but I've talked to other attorneys that you can't appeal if you don't have a recording of the proceedings, that you have a court reporter there. So if you don't have a court reporter, basically the judges understand that you cannot appeal. And so when that happens, I have experienced this, because one time I had a court reporter not show up. And I know other attorneys have experienced this as well. When you go to trial and you don't have a court reporter, the judge will understand that nothing that happens there is going to get reviewed by on any meaningful basis, and so the outcome is predetermined. And I've had a judge tell me to my face that what I did didn't matter because there wasn't a court reporter there.
Okay, that's scary.
Fortunately, that only happened once.
Okay, that's scaring me. Who hires the court reporter?
The parties.
So
it's my job when I go to trial to make sure a court reporter is there if I want one. And ultimately, that's a cost for my client. So in most cases, I've prepared that, I've prepared my client for that expense. It's not significant to have someone show up. It's, $100 usually.
Right.
Now, in the overall scheme of things, when you're talking about a $250,000 house, that's not a big expense. So barring some kind of accident, a court reporter should be present at every trial.
That was my next question to you is should a homeowner have a, if they're fighting the bank, have a court reporter? Because it doesn't seem like it's a lot of money and it protects their rights. If the court reporter for some reason is sick and doesn't show up, and it might be, to me or to you, it might be a silly thing. But if they don't show up, can you change that date and reschedule it? Or are you stuck and then anything goes?
I think if you've hired a court reporter and I think that if I had a court reporter problem, I would tell the judge and try to get a continuance. And based on that one experience, because that was the first and only time I've ever gone to trial without a court reporter, and I'll never do it again because of that experience. So, but I want to circle back around to something you asked me earlier about, sure, about the danger of appeal, about the courts don't feel a danger of appeals. The system is only good as good as the people in it. And like the trial courts, the appellate courts have different judges. And some judges are very, very conscientious, and some judges are, well, I don't want to say they're not, but some judges have different priorities. And then ensuring a scrupulously fair trial. Some judges honestly believe we need to push these things through the system as fast as possible. And they're willing to overlook errors in the process to get the result they think is the appropriate one. Now, because every appellate court is different and every appellate case gets a different set of judges, your outcome is very much dependent on who those judges are. The system is only good, is only as good as the people who are in it.
All right. So when you go to court, who selects the judge? And because I'm sure once you see if a judge is assigned, right away you either go yay or oh gosh.
Judges are randomly assigned in most cases. And in some counties where there may only be one judge assigned to a particular type of law. So in some counties there's one judge assigned to foreclosures.
Okay. If we were in dreamland, if we were in Mike Wasilek's world, you know, we can kind of see that the current foreclosure legal system is not always working. Sometimes it does, sometimes it doesn't. What would you do to change it?
I would simply ask that the court systems apply the same rules to foreclosure cases that they do in every other case. Because under those rules, the fair system actually works. Under those rules, the borrowers have a chance to present actual, real, genuine defenses, to present their side of the story. When they come to court and say, we tried to work with the bank, when they come to court and say, we didn't miss a payment, they dropped, you know, when the bank changes hands and a payment falls through the cracks in between the changeover, I've got cases like that. When we come into court and say, that's what happened, if the court applies the same law evenly to foreclosure cases as it does every other case, those folks have a chance. And that's all I think is really necessary.
Right. I think that's fair as well. Now, what can a homeowner actually expect from trial? What do they expect? Are there different outcomes?
There are. First of all, I want to say that most foreclosure cases, even those where someone's hired a lawyer, are uncontested at the very end of it. And that means that either the homeowner comes in or the homeowner's lawyer comes in and says, Judge, we're just going to go ahead and wave the white flag. And possibly that's in exchange for some kind of small concession like, 120-day sale date instead of a 30-day one. So you get an extra 90 days, something like that. Frankly, I don't think that's of much value if you haven't bothered to fight it up to now. So that's one thing. And there are some lawyers who pretend to do foreclosure defense who will go all the way up to trial and then say, now they'll tell the homeowner, now we need to just go ahead and do what's called consent to judgment, which is, again, waving the white flag in exchange for those tiny little incentives.
So you're saying there are, and I'll agree, there are a lot of stall tactic attorneys, because one question I think a lot of homeowners who are in this situation fail to ask the attorney is, have you ever won anything? They think that because you're a licensed professional, there are, you know, probably hundreds or thousands of foreclosure defense, that's the key word, defense attorneys in the state. They're not on the offensive. They're not really fighting for you. They're just billing you, and really what they're doing is they're stalling it out,
right,
and giving you hope. And I think from the emotional aspect, which this is for people, it's their home, they're thinking, hey, I've got a chance of winning my home, but now you don't have a trial lawyer. A lot of these lawyers out there don't even go to trial, correct?
That's absolutely right. In fact, there are a lot of really good attorneys here in the Bay Area who do foreclosure defense, and they will fight for you. And I mean, I'm one of them, but there's others too. But there are a lot who won't fight, who their only purpose is to stall things out and delay things as long as possible and then try to negotiate the best possible bad deal they can get. And so what I tell people is before you hire somebody to help you out, ask them, have you ever been to trial? Have you ever won a trial? How many trials have you won? What kind of thing do you do to win a trial? And I'm always very proud to answer those questions for myself, because I have had what I think is a pretty good run. And unfortunately, there are a lot of people who – there's one lawyer who advertises in my neighborhood newspaper. On the back, it says, hire local. I've been to court in that city countless times. I've never seen him. I've never seen him in court. And if I don't see him in court, I know he can't be fighting.
Right. And I can tell you, I've talked to a number of attorneys who will say things like, I don't want to go to court. I really don't want to do the work. I just want, and they've told, I mean, they've told that to me, and that's frightening because, you know, I've said, you know, I've referred clients to good attorneys. That's fine. But I check people out, whether it's attorney or plumber or anybody that's licensed, even people that aren't. How, we have about a couple of minutes before the next break. How can people find a good attorney? I mean, I know references, obviously, but how do you know they're good?
Well, again, it goes back to that question. Will you fight for me in trial? Have you gone to trial? Are you afraid to go to trial? I like going to trial. I'm actually a little bit twisted that way. I enjoy going to the courtroom, doing battle when the case is right, which more often than not it is. You know, again, if we've got a good settlement offer on the table, I'll pass it along to the client. I'll talk to the client, consult with the client. But most importantly, the reason my cases settle in a good way when they do settle is because the banks know when I am stepping into court, I'm fighting. And when I fight, a lot of times I win. So.
Right. Well, you sound more like an underdog. You come in and you actually want to do the right thing for the client. You know, you want to accomplish something and help them. And a lot of them, I just see, don't do that. Got about a minute to break. What's your opinion of people who try to represent themselves called pro se? Are there any people who actually win? And I'm not just talking about, I know people can get loan modifications on their own, as difficult as it may be. Have you heard of any cases of people that really won house or, you know, in some other way by representing themselves? And is it something that you would advise?
Generally not. There's one that I know of who actually not only beat his case, he took it up on appeal and had to win it there. He was actually a retired attorney. So okay. he was the classic attorney representing himself, you know.
Right.
The saying we have is fool for a client, but I'm sure everyone's heard of that. But it's very, very, very rare for a borrower to be able to go into court without assistance and get a good result. Now, the bank can always mess up the case in a spectacular way, and the borrower might, in a self-represented case, still win. But it's extremely rare. It's extremely difficult.
All right. Well, stay with us. We're going to be back in just a moment.
Consumers, do you have bad credit? Can't purchase a house or car? Paying too much in interest on your credit cards and loans? Scammed by credit repair companies? There is hope. You can get back on track and do it the right way. Call Credit Education Consultants today at 813-500-6064. That's 813-500-6064. Or go to crediteducationconsultants.com now and get the help you need. Don't delay. Call today. Mortgage reps and realtor inquiries are also welcomed. Do you suffer from back, neck, or body pain? Do you suffer from migraines or have jaw or face pain? Has conventional medicine failed you? Were you injured or in an accident? Call chiropractic physician Dr. Dan Maddock at 813-935-1664. Dr. Dan has helped thousands of patients gain relief for more than 30 years. Dr. Dan is caring, gentle, and takes his time with each patient. He's also a past president of the International Craniopathic Society, a special certification of only 300 chiropractors worldwide. Dr. Dan helps patients from the neck up and the neck down. Dr. Dan accepts most insurance plans. Don't continue to live in pain. Call 813-935-1664 today. That's 813-935-1664. And get on track to better health. You are listening to the Half Empty, Half Full radio show on the Tan Talk Radio Network. And now, here's your host, the consumer champion, Laurie Zoock.
Thanks for staying with us. My guest today is attorney Mike Waslick, and we've been talking about homeowners in trouble and foreclosures, loan modifications, things you can do. And in the last segment, you know, we talked a little bit, or we started talking about, what does it mean to win a case?
That's a great question, Laurie. A foreclosure case, in order for the bank to take the home, in order for the bank to have this home sold at auction, they first have to win the foreclosure lawsuit. And so they start that process. They sue you. They ask the court to grant them certain relief. And in order to do that, they have to get a judgment either at a what's called a summary judgment hearing, which is one where the court just rules summarily based on undisputed facts and just makes a legal conclusion. Or if there's facts that are in dispute, it'll set up a trial. And the trial is just like you might imagine it if you've ever seen one on TV. The only difference is you'd be shocked at how brief most of them are, especially the ones that are uncontested. But the ultimate outcome of the case is that, just like any other lawsuit, one party wins and one party loses. If the bank wins, the foreclosure sale happens, you know, unless there's a post-judgment sale or a settlement. But if the borrower wins, that can mean a number of different things. And it's one of the most common questions I get leading up to trial when I'm talking to a client and I say, I think we've got a good chance of winning this case. And they say, well, what does that mean? Do I own my house? Do I, you know, can I sell it? Can I live in it? What can I do with that? And so I want, and the unfortunately, the unsettling answer is it depends. The first thing it means is that this attempt to take the house has been thwarted, has failed. The bank has been held at bay for at least a little bit. And in some cases, the bank has the right to refile another lawsuit to try again, if, you know, which is really bizarre because in any other type of lawsuit, if I sue somebody for a breach of contract or for a personal injury claim or something like that, and I fail to prove my case, I don't get to come back and try again. But the banks do because they're special.
And that's what I don't exactly understand, because I know the statute of limitations for debt collection in the state of Florida is supposed to be, and you can correct me if I'm wrong, 5 years from the date of the initial delinquency, unless they made a subsequent payment later down the road that resets the clock. So that's on a standard, you know, debt collection issue, say with a credit card or another creditor or a collection agency. But with the banks, if you have a lawsuit against them, how does that go past the 5 years? Because a lot of times the homeowner wants some resolve to the situation, but it's the banks dragging it out for years and years. So it leaves the people in that situation feeling uneasy on a daily basis because it's emotional. They don't know what's happening. What happens with the statute of limitations there?
Well, first of all, it's important to understand what the statute of limitations is. The statute of limitations is a legal statutory bar passed by the legislature that says after a certain amount of time has passed, the parties can no longer file a new lawsuit. Now, for most cases, that time starts ticking when the injury occurs. So, for example, again, in the example of a personal injury, once you have been injured due to someone's negligence and have damages, you can sue for that from that moment on. When you have a breach of contract case, once there's a contract that's been breached, you know, or a broken promise and damages result, you can instantly go into court at that point. With a foreclosure case, all the pieces of the puzzle don't come together necessarily right away. So you're using the example of a credit card debt. That cause of action, the lawsuit, accrues, meaning it becomes available to the plaintiff at the time that the borrower misses their first payment on a revolving debt agreement. But with foreclosures, there are multiple scheduled payments. With a mortgage, there's multiple scheduled payments. And so each individual payment is its own separate cause of action. Now, the statute of limitations doesn't start to running until the cause of action has accrued, which means think of it as baking a cake. All the ingredients have to be in place.
Okay.
So with every other type of case, you have an injury, and once that injury, again, injury damages and something like that, so then you'd be able, all the ingredients are there, you can bake your lawsuit cake and go into court. With a mortgage, because each individual default, each individual payment is its own separate cause of action, the bank could go in and say, okay, well, we're going to sue you for this month's payment or this month's payment or this month's payment. But until they do something that's called acceleration, they can't sue for the entire amount.
Okay.
And acceleration, very simply, is saying all those future payments, they're due now. And the bank has the right to do that under most mortgage contracts. It's part of the contract. It says if you miss a payment, we have the right to optionally accelerate the whole thing. And until the loan is accelerated, that's the last piece of the puzzle. That's when all the ingredients to the cake are there, and that's when the bank can sue for the entire amount. And that's when the statute of limitations starts running. Now, and there's one more wrinkle.
Okay.
The other wrinkle is that acceleration can occur in a couple different ways, but it requires the bank to clearly communicate to the borrower that the acceleration has occurred. One way in which to do that, and the way in which most banks choose to do that, is by filing a lawsuit for the entire amount. So what that means is that, unlike any other type of lawsuit, the last element falls into place at the same time the lawsuit is filed. So a statute of limitations never bars the first suit in a foreclosure action unless the mortgage has the 30 years has expired and 5 years down the road.
Okay, so let me see if I have this right. You were using, you know, baking a cake as an analogy, having all the ingredients. So what you're saying in English is the statute of limitations, where I was talking about 5 years, is really – it doesn't go into play until you have all the components of that cake to bake it. Once they're all there, then you have the right. five years. Okay,
that's
I've got
exactly
that
right.
Now, let me ask you another trick question. I like the doozy questions. Banks often told homeowners – that they couldn't do loan modifications unless they stopped paying for 3 months. But in essence, isn't that breaching their own contract by telling the homeowner not to pay them?
Well, it's absolutely something that can be used as a defense in court. I've raised that in many cases. I've won cases on that basis where a bank tells a borrower, stop making payments, and we promise not to foreclose on you. That is a separate promise, and that is a separate agreement. And actually, there's a Florida Supreme Court case that says when the lender engages in certain types of conduct that lead the borrower to believe they won't be foreclosed on, that is a defense to foreclosure, and that justifies denying the foreclosure entirely.
Now, is that what you call a deceptive practice?
Well, that's one way of that would be one thing you could label it under Florida law prohibits deceptive practices, but also too we call it. There's a variety of things. There's a variety of different labels lawyers can slap on that, but we just call it. You know, you can call it bad faith. You can call it estoppel. All kinds of different things you could label that.
So, in a lot of your cases, do you find that there are contract breaches? Because we were talking about winning, and I believe if you can find something that they did first, right, you have a chance of winning that case.
Absolutely.
Okay, and we're going to come back to winning cases. I want to cover that at the end of the show. Quiet title. I've heard that term lots of times. And I think I have an understanding of it, but I'm not sure I have the complete understanding of it. Can you explain what quiet title is, how it works?
Absolutely. And the way it comes up in what I do is because in a case where the statute of limitations is run and bars the bank from refiling and we've won the case, you know, where the case has been dismissed, the statute of limitations is run because the case lasted more than 5 years. And by the way, the statute of limitations doesn't extinguish an existing case. It just prevents a new case from cropping up.
Okay.
That's an important distinction that a lot of people get confused about. But
you need a flow chart.
Yeah, I do. Radio may not be the best medium to talk about this. But the mortgage lien doesn't just vanish automatically because the statute of limitations is run and there's no pending foreclosure case. And so what I tell people is that winning the case means they can't take your home from you because they can't refile it as long as you're vigilant and know that you have those defenses. You can live there. You can rent it out. You can do lots of different – you know, fix it up. You can do anything that a normal owner would be able to do. But the problem is that if you try to sell it, there's this mortgage that's still part of the public record. And if you believe that you are free and clear of that mortgage, if you have the right to sell your home free of that mortgage because either the statute of limitations is run or there's some other reason that invalidates that mortgage, then you might need to, in order to sell your property and have clear title to convey, clear title to give to the buyer, you might need to ask the court to declare that your title is clear. And that's called a quiet title action.
Okay, because I hear the terms clouded title. That means that there's something still on the title, so you can't, as the homeowner, get it free and clear, so to speak. Do I have
exactly.
that correct?
Exactly.
Okay. Give me some real life – I mean, this would come under winning, but give me some real examples of real life cases, you know, maybe that you've handled or not handled, involving quiet title actions.
Well, generally speaking, with a quiet title action, and this is going to be a little bit difficult to get into. But again, where there, I've had a number of cases where the case itself lasted more than 5 years, and at the end of that 5 years or 6 years or whatever, the case was dismissed either because we went to trial and won. I've had that happen. Or because the court wanted to find out what was taking so long, held a, you know, case management conference, and no one showed up, so they threw it out for the bank. No one showed up, and so they threw it out. There's all kinds of ways that cases get thrown out, and if the statute of limitations has passed, and there's no foreclosure case, and the homeowner wants to sell, the obstacle they have is just that mortgage on the public record, and so what they have to do, they have to quiet the title.
So
that's the type of situation where you might consider it. If you want to live in it till you die, maybe not so important. But if you want to sell it, at all, then you're going to want to at least look at whether or not that's appropriate.
Well, I can see why it would be difficult for anybody to represent themselves, because I understand a lot of the concepts that you're talking about, but I'm not an attorney. And just the thought of understanding everything that you explained and, you know, and putting it down in layman's terms, it can be somewhat difficult.
A lot of lawyers don't understand that.
Well, hang with us. We still have one more segment to go, one more quarter to go, and we'll do a wrap up in that segment. We'll be right back.
Consumers, do you have bad credit? Can't purchase a house or car? Paying too much in interest on your credit cards and loans? Scammed by credit repair companies? There is hope. You can get back on track and do it the right way. Call Credit Education Consultants today at 813-500-6064. That's 813-500-6064. Or go to crediteducationconsultants.com now and get the help you need. Don't delay. Call today. Mortgage reps and realtor inquiries are also welcomed. Do you suffer from back, neck, or body pain? Do you suffer from migraines or have jaw or face pain? Has conventional medicine failed you? Were you injured or in an accident? Call chiropractic physician Dr. Dan Maddock at 813-935-1664. Dr. Dan has helped thousands of patients gain relief for more than 30 years. Dr. Dan is caring, gentle, and takes his time with each patient. He's also a past president of the International Craniopathic Society, a special certification of only 300 chiropractors worldwide. Dr. Dan helps patients from the neck up and the neck down. Dr. Dan accepts most insurance plans. Don't continue to live in pain. Call 813-935-1664 today. That's 813-935-1664. And get on track to better health. You're listening to the Half Empty, Half Full Radio Show on the Tan Talk Radio Network. Now, here's your host, the consumer champion, Laurie Zoock.
Welcome back. My guest today is attorney Mike Roslick, and we're talking about problems homeowners have when it comes to foreclosures, loan modifications, you know. And actually, before we get to my next question, I wanted to ask you one more regarding when you go to court. When you get to court, is it a jury trial or is it a judge trial, or do you get to choose? And how does that part work?
Foreclosure cases are judge trials, except in really very unusual circumstances where there are types of counterclaims that might require a jury. And both the state law and the mortgage contract will typically say that the case can be tried without a jury. And the mortgage contract will actually waive jury trial rights for most types of claims that relate to the mortgage contract. So that includes the foreclosure.
What about mediations? I also hear that term. Is that something that you've been successful with in any type of foreclosure action?
Yes. Mediations are a assisted settlement process. You have the borrower, you have the lender come to the table in the same room, and there's a neutral third party whose job it is not to judge the case, but to assist the parties in negotiating some kind of resolution, whether it's a loan mod, whether it's a walk away, you know, because sometimes you can negotiate a walk away from the debt and surrender the home. There's all kinds of different ways to negotiate a settlement, and the job of the mediator is to help the parties reach that. And in some cases, it can be very successful. Most of the time, the banks have proven, in my view, unwilling to make meaningful settlement offers. But in those cases they do, they can be significant.
All right. Well, let me ask you one more question. Why are they not willing to settle out these cases? I mean, one of the things I've heard is if they keep these foreclosure properties on the books for a long enough period, they're getting some type of benefit. I'm not sure if it's a tax benefit, but I have heard that before. So why don't they want to settle out and do the right thing?
One of the largest frustrations I hear from my clients and from other people in foreclosure is if they would just take this deal, they'd get more money. They'd be better off.
Right, because they're paying their attorneys, a small fortune, and those attorneys are getting billable hours from the bank, and they're dragging it out. I can see that as a reason.
Well, it's not the attorneys necessarily that are dragging it out. What I see is a few things, and you kind of touched on this in your question, which is that whenever I think a bank is acting illogically, I've found that there's almost always some kind of hidden incentive. It may be a tax incentive. It may be a financial incentive. It may be a legal incentive. So to give you an example, a hidden financial incentive would be that perhaps the servicers who are controlling the lawyers get paid more to service a foreclosure case than they do a case that's where the loan is current. So that may be a hidden incentive. The banks also have some concerns about if we give this guy a break, then other people are going to deliberately miss their payments and try to get breaks as well, despite the fact that they're telling them that, you know, on the side.
Yeah, yeah.
But the idea is that the bank may be willing to look at the bigger picture and say, we'll take a loss on this deal because we don't want to give incentives to people to have more defaults. So there's all kinds of different incentives that could be at play.
So when you go to court for a homeowner, they go, oh my gosh, here comes Mike. We know, you know, he's going to be a problem. In other words, are they aware of attorneys that are going to fight it? And they know they're up for a challenge against one of these stall-out attorneys that aren't going to really do anything. I would think that would have a lot to play in because a lot of attorneys know each other.
I'd like to think that there's a dartboard somewhere in a bank with my face on it. But the reality is that everybody who works in this field pretty much knows each other. And everybody knows who's fighting and who's not. And so that will affect the advice the lawyers give to their clients, the banks. And it will affect the advice I give to my clients. You know, I know when I've got somebody on the other side who's really going to fight me, and vice versa. And so that does affect the advice I give you. This is going to be an uphill battle, or this should be a cakewalk. You know, I try to avoid inflating people's hopes, but
you want to give them a reality check, and you I'm assuming you kind of want to figure out, is this client really up for the challenge of doing it? Because I think sometimes they think it's a piece of cake and it's a fight, and if you're not willing to stand up for your rights, then the bank's going
to
win.
Most people who come to me are ready to fight, and frankly, that's
kind
of the
ideal.
That's the ideal client for me, because somebody who's willing to fight to get the good result now, which means that if we get a good settlement offer, they'll consider it. But they'll fight to get to that point, or they'll fight all the way through if we have to. If somebody's not really interested in fighting, they're not going to be a good match for me.
Right, right. All right. Well, I want to talk a little bit about credit reporting, because that plays a lot. You know, as a credit consultant, I often get asked, you know, what's better on my credit report? Not that any of it's better. You know, what's better, a foreclosure, a short sale, a loan mod? What's better? Well, the answer is really it doesn't matter, because once you miss that first payment, FICO, Fair ISA Company, has stated it's 1 to 200 points on the first hit. You know, after that, they don't let you know, but I'm sure it's subsequently less or you'd have zero score. So, you know, explain, because I know that's also your specialty, what is the Fair Credit Reporting Act?
Well, it's funny that, you know, what's worse on your credit report? It's like, do you want to die by shooting, burning, or drowning? They're all bad. You don't want to do that. Everybody knows what a credit reporting agency is, or has an idea what that is. And the Fair Credit Reporting Act is the federal statute. It's the federal law that regulates credit reporting agencies, CRAs. And it requires them to do a number of different things. In theory, it requires them to keep accurate records. It requires them to be responsive to consumer complaints. And it imposes penalties for failure to do those things. I say again in theory because it doesn't always work that way. And in fact, the CRA lobbyists have carved out substantial exceptions to those requirements.
Well, that's true. I'll agree with that because, you know, when you challenge things through the credit bureaus, they're basically a repository for the information. So a lot of people, you know, think if they challenge it on their credit reports, it's probably going to come off. In reality, it doesn't, because the banks, the creditors, the collection agencies, they're the customers for the credit bureaus. They are paying the credit bureaus to subscribe to them. Most people don't realize that. They think, hey, I'm paying for a credit report. Well, you're nothing but a peon, because these larger companies, these larger banks, they're paying lots of money to the banks. I'm sorry, to the credit bureaus. And all they do is do an email verification system with a two-digit code that comes back. No one pulls any papers and looks at anything. So, you know, how do you think, you know, loan modifications, foreclosures, and short sales affect credit reporting? What have you seen?
Well, this is a real hot-button issue. I mean, I have clients who, when we talk about settling, one of the things they'll want to do is they'll want to negotiate the credit reporting. They'll want to try and get unfavorable information off the record. And the thing I get from the banks, which is an absolute lie, is they say, we're not allowed to delete negative trailing. Well, of course you are. Of course you are. And so they're saying, well, we can't report untruthful information. I say, I'm not asking you to lie on anything. I'm asking you to remain silent, which you always can do. And so as far as the different impact between a loan modification, a foreclosure, and a short sale, in my view, nobody outside of Fair Isaac can really tell you how many points are assigned to any particular thing. And even one event in one person's credit history is going to be weighed differently than that same event in another person's credit history, because the formula is secret.
Right.
And possibly very complex. It's got to be complex enough that you can't just figure it out by looking at your credit report or looking at a dozen different credit reports.
Well, that's correct. And each credit bureau actually uses a slightly different variation of the FICO. There really is no such thing as a FICO. People don't realize that. It could change daily. Each credit bureau modifies their own version. And if you go to, say, a car lender versus a bank lender for a house, those are different FICO scores. And to me, what's even scarier is when you have companies with the names, I won't mention them, but implying that the credit report is free. They got fined for that. The only free one is annualcreditreport.com, which is, by the way, very difficult to get, because I'm a credit consultant and I could only get one answering the questions. They had to mail me the other two. So the credit bureaus tend to be very difficult to deal with.
Yes.
The other thing I want to comment with you on is, you're correct, none of these companies, none of the banks, none of the collection agencies, they're going to tell you, the consumer, that we can't because it's the law. There is no law that states that they can't negotiate or change it. And what most people don't know is a little industry secret. It's called the Automated Universal Data Form. And I don't know if you know what that is. It took me a couple of years to actually be able to get a copy of it. And it's just simply a form where they list the account information and they check off the box that says delete. So most people don't know that when they're negotiating on these debt collection issues, even if it's for a house, that you can negotiate it to be deleted off the reports. It depends upon how hard you're going to fight. And of course, if you have an attorney, I think that fight becomes a lot easier than for a regular consumer, because typically they're not going to let their attorneys speak to you, the consumer.
Well, I'll tell you, I found that negotiating credit reporting has been more difficult. I'm more likely to get a bank to knock hundreds of thousands of dollars off of a mortgage than to let them report it as paid in full. And, partly that's because the banks have bought the loans for pennies on the dollar and they're still making a profit even doing that. But
right,
they're really fiercely protective of those credit reports, because it's almost like a scarlet letter. It's like they want you
to suffer.
They want you to suffer. And a lot of people have their self-worth or their self-esteem wrapped up in how good their credit score is. They think it's a measure of how good they are as a person. It's not. It's a measure of how much money the banks think they can make off you.
Right, exactly. And the worse your scores are, the higher the interest rates on any loan you get. And the more you don't know about your credit reports, the worse they will stay for longer periods of time. But most people don't even know that they can check their credit reports yearly on annualcreditreport.com and look, people, at what's on your reports, because you may see things that aren't even yours. And a lot of people don't realize that. We've only got a minute or two left, but let me ask you, do you sue lenders under the Fair Credit Reporting Act? And what about credit reputation damages?
Well, you absolutely, there is a federal, the federal law allows you to sue if there's inaccurate information on your report and if it's caused you damages. And in fact, if you've been declined for credit or had an adverse credit action, which can, by the way, include not getting a job because you have a bad credit score, they're required to notify you of they've taken that information into account and what information they've taken into account and why and what they've done with it. And if you have an adverse credit action that's based on inaccurate information, absolutely you can do that. And if the inaccurate information is on your credit report at all and you are able to prove that and they refuse to remove it, then there are remedies for that as well. Again, you can go into court and you can sue and you can obtain not only statutory damages of up to, I think it's $1,000 per hit, but also, if you have suffered actual damages, if you've gotten upcharged on a mortgage for an APR, you can recover those damages, and they can range up into the six figures if it's on a mortgage or if it's serious enough.
Well, before we leave, the goal of the show is to educate people. Can you give out your phone number, because if people have questions, you're an attorney. Tell us how they can reach you.
Absolutely. My phone number is 352-567-3173. That's 352-567-3173. That rings to our Dade City office, which is where I'm usually at. And if you have a question about foreclosures, if you want to talk about other consumer issues, abusive debt collection, credit issues, please give us a call. We offer free half-hour consultation.
Great. Thanks for joining us. And join us every Thursday night at 11 p.m. for a new Half Empty, Half Full Talk radio show on the 1340 AM Tantalk Network Learn something new every week and be safe.